Namaskara, Vanakkam, good evening and welcome to today's BIC stream session, The Poet, Politician, Karunanidhi Alive. Writer-politician Muthuvel Karunanidhi is amongst the most important political figures India has ever seen. He was the Chief Minister of Tamil Nadu for 5 terms and leader of the Dravida Munnetra Kalagam, DMK, for over 5 decades. Still remembered for his fruitful career as a regional leader who helped in the formation of various coalition governments at Delhi, his contribution to Tamil history and culture has been invaluable. Our speaker for today, A.S. Paneerselvan, has written a meticulously researched and deeply engrossing book, Karunanidhi, A Life, which delves into the life and times of this unforgettable man. In conversation with author, columnist, and faculty at Asian College of Journalism, A.S. Paneerselvan, is journalist Rohini Mohan. The speaker bios will appear in the chat box at the bottom of your Zoom screen. And if you have any questions through the session, please feel free to use the Q&A box also at the bottom of your Zoom screen. And with that, I hand it over to Rohini.
Thank you, Lekha. Welcome everyone to this conversation. I've spent the last week rereading parts of this book on Karunanidhi, A Life by A.S. Paneerselvan. And so much of my initiation into Tamil Nadu politics is actually from listening to Karunanidhi. And a lot of those insights about questions about why he was so controversial, what a contradictory man, was he anti-Hindu, why did he love Tamil so much, how did he manage writing 67 film scripts while also being a chief minister 5 times, also being the leader of the Dravida Munnetra Kazhagam, all of these things in a 94-year-old life. There is so much to pack in, and Mr. Paneerselvan does it by using a very a traditional Tamil method of mixing the personal and the political, that is the agam and the puram. And this is actually a great way to do it, because for this particular politician, who's a poet and a politician, the personal is the political and the political was quite personal. So maybe I'll begin with actually finding out why you decided to write about Karunanidhi, because in your introduction, I found it quite fascinating. You write about the conversation, right, that Gerald Martin, who's a biographer of Gabriel Garcia Marquez, he says that the reason he wrote about this, the great novelist, is I read from the introduction that Paneerselvan has written. Only the foolish and the deluded would begin such a task, led on perhaps by the possibility of communing and identifying with the great, the good, or the merely famous. If ever a subject was worth investing a quarter of one's own life in, it would undoubtedly be the extraordinary life and career of Marquez. And then Paneerselvan writes, what Marquez meant to Martin is what Karunanidhi means to me. What did you mean by that?
I would not have ventured into this book if I was not covering Sri Lanka. Because at some level, Karunanidhi gave an idea of understanding the ability to negotiate with centralizing forces. I had this idea of looking at the nation state through two streams. One is coming together, another one is holding together. Holding together is power centric, and coming together is a democratic idea. And I felt that Karunanidhi always represented coming together. Therefore, I wanted to understand how somebody whose essential politics is coming together works. What are the triggers that leads to that position? That was the most interesting element for me. If I had not covered Sri Lanka between 1984 and 1993, in 1993, it would not have become the biography of Mr. Karunanidhi. For that, Sri Lanka at some level was in the back of my mind because it was about the coming together element. Another interesting aspect is I was fascinated by this idea of politicians articulating their political views through writings and other art forms. Karunanidhi had a completely different idea. He said that I'm not using art as an instrumental element. I'm using art as an integral and organic manifestation of my politics. Therefore, I wanted to actually explore this idea because the politics was evident.
Since he was talking about his art, you know, I was going through the back of the book where he lists Karunanidhi's creative world, and it goes on for pages and pages. 67 films, 46 short stories, 15 plays. Starting at the age of 20, he wrote his first play. Novels, 10 novels, and of course many speeches. And he used to write every day a letter in Murasoli, which was the DMK paper, official paper, addressing the party cadres in Udanpirpe, my brothers. Yeah. So since he was talking about it, and since we were waiting for him to come back, I just thought I'd mention. Welcome back.
I don't know at what point we got cut off.
Oh no, you did. You were talking about how integral art was to his politics. And he said
this idea of art as an intrinsic activity as well as an instrumental activity. These two trajectories were not contradiction for him. And that was another fascinating element for me. Mm-hmm. That's how I got into it. And another element which was important for me was the amount of details which are getting lost in translation. Therefore, the things which are getting lost in translation, how to negotiate these elements? Even in this book, I have actually skipped quite a few things because I don't have that ability to render those things in English because it was eluding the requirements of the English language. But what was lost in translation was also this idea of coming together versus holding together politics. If it was not lost, people would have seen that he is actually giving a way to negotiate the center-state relations.
In the context of translation, he is a very difficult man to translate into English, especially because of the wit and the many meanings wrapped into one, right? So I remember as a journalist, a TV journalist in Chennai, when we had to go and get a soundbite from him, we'd come back with a great happiness about something pithy he has just delivered, but it was impossible to subtitle it. So, I mean, today's conversation in the spirit of inclusivity is in English, but please, in the spirit of federal pleasure, please slip into any Tamil quips that you know you remember from any of the people that you've interviewed, because you've interviewed him over a long time. You wrote the book over 20 years, but you have been a journalist in Tamil Nadu for a long time as the chief bureau of Outlook. Also now you're with the Hindu, the Reader's editor. You were also briefly for 4 years or 3.5 years with Sun TV as its editor. So this gave you a lot of insight into him. Interviewing the man several times, what was the sense you got of his relationship with the media? And you must have had both off the record and on the record conversations. What is the sense you got of him as a person?
See, Karunanidhi, till the advent of multiple cameras, that is the post-television boom of 1996, is completely different from Karunanidhi before 1996. Because before the advent of camera, there was a space for you to talk. Therefore, not everything is getting recorded, and therefore, people were not guarded. Therefore, the interaction between 1984 to 1996 are much more important in for my own understanding than after the gaze of the camera. The problem with the gaze of the camera is that it picks up everything and it also removes the context. Therefore, as a political leader, you are not going to say that, no, that's not what I meant. Therefore, they all became extremely guarded. And even Mr. Karunanidhi became guarded. But earlier, when you are going for an interaction with them, there'll be a formal interaction for, say, half an hour. And then you can spend another half an hour asking him to explain on what basis he arrived at those decisions. See, the most interesting thing is now we witness a huge cabinet reshuffle, but we don't have a single explanation on what basis some ministers were dropped, on what basis some ministers were taken in. Whereas with Mr. Karunanidhi, you can go and ask him. You list out the names and he'll say, for these reasons, I picked them up. And for these reasons, people have been left out or they have been asked to do the party work. And the explanation was coming from the top. The value of Mr. Karunanidhi is realized only after 2014, when you are not getting any formal briefing for all the decisions which have been taken.
You know, a lot of times this is this holding together and coming together that they're talking about, you also a lot of times mention this difference between conciliation and compromise in the book. And often in choosing to balance social justice ideals of the Dravidian movement with the reality of politics, Karunanidhi was often accused of diluting some of those ideals. But you say that what he was trying to do is conciliation. Can you talk about that? With some examples maybe.
The most important thing is he realized that the biggest problem is not dealing with rival political parties. Biggest problem is the centralizing deep Indian state. And the centralizing deep Indian state gets manifested in the way the courts were handling crucial issues. There were the central aspect like reservation or linguistic rights. The courts had a completely different viewpoint. In fact, the first amendment to the Indian constitution happened because of social justice movement of Tamil Nadu. It is called the Champakam Durairajan versus State of Tamil Madras case. The Champakam Durairajan versus State of Madras state is that it was a case filed by a person who said that the reservation has denied a medical seat for the candidate. And the High Court as well as the Supreme Court upheld that argument, which means actually preferential reservation was abolished with that judgment. Then Government of India has to bring in the amendment, and that's how we get our first amendment. If the US first amendment gave freedom of expression, India's first amendment gave the right for affirmative action. And that came from here. Therefore, they were very, very clear that you are not only negotiating with political opponents, but you're also negotiating with a deep state which has a centralizing tendency ingrained in it. Therefore, if you're going to have a centralizing tendency ingrained in a deep state, you have to find multiple creative ways to negotiate. In fact, once Murasoli Maharan used this wonderful word. He said that ours has been a long journey of continuous subtle subversions. I thought that actually captured that spirit in a far more interesting manner. He said it's a long journey of continuous subtle subversions. Therefore, it needed to be defined in a different manner. For instance, they said that revolution has a problem. The problem with the revolution is that a counter-revolution can wipe out all the gains. Therefore, what we are looking at is a incremental, irreversible changes. Again, this was seen as a very, very important lesson for me to understand how they negotiated these crucial issues. The way it is, continuous subtle subversions and incremental irreversible changes are the two pillars through which they negotiated centralizing power. And that negotiation has quite a lot of interesting lessons for other states also. Now, if you're looking at what is happening in West Bengal, this can come in as a huge lesson for TMC to negotiate with the centralizing center.
This idea of him representing, and Tamil Nadu still continues to be among the most vocal voices for federal power, for state autonomy. I mean, West Bengal and Kerala do it, but somehow Tamil Nadu is always the rebel in the group, right? Always speaking, even today. This, but he also, Karunanidhi, you write in detail about how he tried several times to bring parties from other states together repeatedly, again and again. NTR, NT Ram Rao, Devi Gowda have all said, even after he, after Karunanidhi passed away, about how much he worked at bringing these groups together. What is your sense from, you know, speaking to him and also reading his autobiography, the 6 volumes, of you know, what is the motivating force? One is the linguistic pride and the need for this heterogeneity in the democracy. But where did it come from? And there has not been actually a durable union of all these different state parties. There has not, it has not happened over time. So how did, what were his attempts coming from?
He felt that if Congress had a Jai Jeevan Ram approach, or if the Janata Parivar had a Biju Patnaik approach, things would have been much more feasible to bring in diverse groups together. He said that all these things, we cannot look at it as a monolith. He said Janata Parivar is not monolith because Mr. Morarji Desai represented extremely centralizing Janata Parivar's imagination. And Mr. Biju Patnaik manifestedly, his politics was for a collective governance. Similarly, within Congress, he looked at Jai Jeevan Ram as a person who was more accommodative. So with this idea of accommodation, he says that was cutting across party lines. He said that it's very, very difficult to put this idea of centralizing only with the Hindutva-led BJP. He said even with the Congress, there is an attempt to centralize, and this extreme centralization gave them a sense of comfort. And he says that partition was just an excuse for centralization. He says that if partition had not happened, they would have discovered some other reason for centralization. Because he says that all the reasons which have been attributed to partition are not well argued out. They are comfortable, and it resonated at that time when the Constituent Assembly was meeting between 48 and 50, talking about partition actually resonated. But in that sense, Karunanidhi, as a politician who was looking at running the government as well as negotiating an extremely centralizing deep state, that was a question, because one of the element which was coming out throughout the, my research is that they were never permitted to settle down. They were being always challenged through different methods. For instance, their idea of linguistic pride was called chauvinism. Their idea of social justice was called casteism. And when they wanted to establish themselves as a powerful force, even in Rajya Sabha, because in 62 they get 50 MLAs and they send their first Rajya Sabha nominee, which was C.N. Annadurai himself, the party was facing its first existential crisis. They were using the China war. There was an attempt to even deregister the political party. But right from the beginning, they were never permitted to settle down. In 1971, they get that massive mandate. But immediately after the massive mandate, party was split. Today, everybody understands the role of income tax or ED and everything else. In 71, when the MJR split happened, it was not a common knowledge. Not a lot of people realize that central agencies can be deployed for partisan political consideration. With the West Bengal experiment, now lots of people are aware of the way the center deals with regional parties. But at 71, 72, when that happened, the split in the DMK happened, very few people actually realized the power of the center. So given these facts, and that they were dismissed twice, and Tamil Nadu is the only state where DMK was dismissed twice and the NDMK was dismissed twice. Karunanidhi's government was dismissed in 76 and in 1991. MJ's government was dismissed in 1980 and Janaki Ramachandran's government was dismissed in 1988. Therefore, there's also this idea of dismissal, which forms the sense of disquiet through which they are to negotiate this deep state. Therefore, what I try to do is, this disquiet did not drop their ability to mount counter narratives. This disquiet gave them to find new ways of articulating their aspirations. And that's the reason every time aspiration was coming up in a different format. If it was Dravidanadu at the beginning, after coming to power, it becomes Justice Rajamannar Committee on Center-State Relations. Therefore, you have the former Chief Justice of the High Court heading the committee to look into the center-state relations. Even now with NEET, they actually constituted a committee which was headed by a former judge, because they feel that at the end of the day, the most difficult question is dealing with the judiciary. And their fear of a judiciary is actually now well substantiated. For instance, after the abrogation of the Article 370, the Supreme Court is yet to hear that case. That's the most important constitutional case facing this nation. Given this element of the way the judiciary helps executive in centralizing power, they wanted to negotiate this element through range of narratives. And one of the narrative is having a counter legalistic arguments. And that generating that counter legalistic arguments was not easy, because it was immediately labeled as separatist. It was immediately labeled as fissiferous tendencies. It was labeled as people who are creating trouble. Therefore, you have to negotiate this in a much more careful manner.
So, I mean, we've been talking about the center state pull and push, but in the state itself, in Tamil Nadu itself, the ideas that it's almost, they merge into each other. The ideas that Karunanidhi had, then into the DMK, then into the popular perception of among Tamilians and people who are resident in Tamil Nadu about what their state is about or what their government is about. They all flow into each other. So this probably comes from the way the party and Karunanidhi communicated some of their decisions or some of the ideas that they were trying to implement. Can you talk about that?
See, one instance which I want to say is that we have been talking about lost in translation. For instance, people have no problem in understanding any of the affirmative action. They don't see it as freebies. But the moment you are removed from the state, you see it as freebies. They think this as an obligation of the state to address the growing inequality. The way the common people understood the certain amount of the interventions from the state. And the most interesting element, what I have noticed is after 58-59, there have been changes in governments. But each change followed by intense political one-upmanship. But that intense political one-upmanship helped the state to gain. For instance, if Kamraj contributed for the fundamental primary education infrastructure of the state, a DMK which came to power in 67 expanded on it. If DMK expanded on it, MJR comes with this noon meal scheme, strengthening it. At one level, it is intense politicking. At another level, that intense politicking strengthened the state's infrastructure. I think the first time that intense politicking started hurting the state happened only in 2011, when the library was converted into a marriage hall, the secretariat was converted into a hospital. Well, till 2011, if you're going to look at it, we are talking about East Stream, which started around 57. Yes, it's true that there was intense politicking and everybody wanted to say that they are better than their rivals. But that rivalry generated opportunities for people. Whether it was even in the industrial policy, Kamaraj and R. Venkatraman created a particular type of industrial infrastructure that was bettered by Karunanidhi and S. Madhavan. And what Karunanidhi and S. Madhavan created was bettered by later M. G. Ramachandran. And in 1991, when Jayalalitha comes to power and liberalization happens, she opens up the space for the FDI in a particular manner. And in 1996, it takes another leap. What I also notice is that the intense politicking which is happening within the state was beneficial for the state. If that had continued even after 2011, we would have been in a far better situation. Unfortunately, from 2011, it took a different turn because by 2011, it actually mimicked the way the national parties behave. National parties generally undo the best thing brought in by the earlier person.
Why was this? You must have discussed with him and others. Why was this? Why is the intense politicking not bringing each other down, but these irreversible movements and then forward? Why does that happen? And only it seems almost like an outlier, Tamil Nadu, in this. Why is that?
See, they said that at least in 7 or 8 sectors, they even permitted the key personnel to continue. For instance, Yale Mudaliar, he continued as a vice chancellor of Madras for so many years under various regimes. N.D. Sundaravidyadu, as the director of school education, continued under various regimes. Therefore, what they said is, it's change in the political parties should not affect the areas where we are able to deliver. There have been changes in so many other departments, but in these areas, there was a huge continuity. And this continuity comes only when we start actually naming people. Otherwise, it looks very, very abstract idea. Only when we look at somebody like A.L. Mudaliar, who continued as the Vice Chancellor for Madras for so many terms under different chief ministers, then you see a continuity there. Only when you look at somebody like N.D. Sundaravidyadu as the director of school education, continuing under various regimes. And finally, he was elevated as the vice chancellor of the Madras University. A person was recognized for his contribution for school education to head the higher education institution of the state. There was a political culture which was intensely competitive, but also had an underlying element of cooperation. Therefore, competition and cooperation went hand in hand. I think that is one element which was completely missing when Tamil Nadu was reported outside Tamil Nadu, because it was seen through the prism of glamour. Yes, these people had come from film industries. They had a big stake in performances. They were writers. They were artists. Writers, filmmakers, was given a different type of a gloss. And in the process of giving this gloss, we lost out on what they actually brought to the table.
The administrative part is fascinating, but I wouldn't even, while we shouldn't dismiss the glam, we can dismiss the glamorous perception, the artistry and the literary bent of mind did have play a role in how they saw and how they communicated maybe the expectations or what the public should expect from government, right? That did play a part, that artistic view.
See, what they realized is that they did not have the edge of the left, because left's artistic engagement, especially IPTA, was respected. documented. Whereas their artistic engagement was not actually getting the due share. That is primarily because Yipta was also bilingual. Quite a lot of Yipta practitioners were very good in English, whereas these people were essentially writing in Tamil. And Tamil was negotiated through English in a second-hand translation. It was not actually, when I say second-hand translation, it was literal translation. Certain nuances were completely lost. For instance, when I met Mr. Karunanidhi for on a completely different occasion, I was asking him about his relationship with Tamil Brahmins. He said that, as a political leader, I am very, very clear. I have constituted any number of committees. In all my committees, there were Soru and Sadam. That's what he said in Tamil. They don't recognize that. I have never constituted a committee without Sadam. Now, how are you going to translate this Soru and Sadam into English? At some level, it's both cooked rice. But the social register in that word is very, very important. He said that we have been inclusive. And people who are exclusive are accusing us of not being inclusive enough. And then he goes back to this idea of actually non-Brahmin as a category. He says that what is non-Brahmin as a category? Non-Brahmin as a category includes so many people. How can it be an exclusive category? It is essentially saying that people who have been excluded from decision-making apparatus have been brought together as one unit to leverage certain amount of space for themselves. Mm. The way he looked at the non-Brahmin manifesto itself was very, very interesting. The way he said that non-Brahmin is not an exclusionary word. He says it's an inclusionary word. So for the first time, he uses the word non for inclusive and non not as the one which constitutes outside. Mm-hmm. And that happens with certain amount of linguistic flourish. It worked extremely well in Tamil. I don't think I will be able to translate it quickly, or even if I translate it, I don't think it will be effective. Yeah. But that was the crux of it. Crux was non is not an exclusionary word. Non is an inclusionary word. That actually is a very, very important point to understand his own worldview.
Mm. The Karunanidhi and the DMK as an extension have offered, because we are talking about caste, have sometimes been accused by, you know, Dalit scholars and Dalit groups of empowering the backward classes in the movement, but not, and sidelining the Dalits. He must have, you must have had conversations with him or read about what he thought of this.
This question has been coming repeatedly, because the first major crisis DMK had to handle was in 1968, when Keeravanmini tragedy happened. Keeravanmini, as everybody knows, was the place in which 44 Dalits were burnt to death. From Keeravanmini onwards, he's saying that the Dalit question remains very, very important. We are not able to address it fully, but what we managed to achieve is no other state has managed to achieve. We have managed to keep it as a extremely localized event. We don't permit it to spill over. Therefore, if it is going to be Keeravanmini, it doesn't spread across Tanjavur district. Mm. If it was a Uttapuram wall, it failed to reach even Madurai. The only difference between Tamil Nadu and other states is that this 100 years of self-respect movement helped us to contain certain excesses within the region. And that is the, he says that it's an inadequate development. We need to do more. But what we are talking is, we are not talking about uneven relationship which came up today. We're talking about an historical inheritance. When you're talking about the historical inheritance, we are not talking about a perfect solution as yet. The only comfort we have is, that is according to him, the Dravidian leaders have, is that we are able to contain it. That's the reason Papa Patti, Kiri Patti election also, we are able to finally have the elections. We need to move further, but he said that using the Dalits' plight, we have also created specific institutional arrangement so that the Dalits are not given token presence in any of our structures. Therefore, the party's first propaganda secretary was Satyavani Muthu. And later, A. Raja was given ministries like environment and telecom. Paruthi Ilamurthy was given ministry like MMDA. He says that, look, we are not permitting them to be purely a token representation within our structures. They were given whatever is seen as influential or transformative ministries. Well, there's a conscious effort to know that there's a gap between what we want and what we have achieved. But that gap between what we want and what we have achieved is not only with Dalits. Even about the level of reduction in poverty, or even reduction in the urban-rural divide, or even the gender equality, there's a big gap. And that gap, if you actually take sector-wise, the gap in the Dalit issue is the same as the gap in all other aspiration versus where we are. That's what he said. And he said that you will actually share data about it, but we couldn't really get into it because that was the time he started writing this serial on Ramanujam. And he said that how his idea of Ramanujam is different from others. And we were supposed to have a extended discussion on that, but unfortunately, he lost his voice and then his health went down and we couldn't discuss on that issue.
Yeah, in that serial, you noted in the book that that was one gap you saw that he didn't, it wasn't launched in a digital format, it was analog. That was an interesting, even that late into, into what, 2000s? Was it 16?
15.
15, yeah.
15, yeah.
There's a lot of times you've tried, you move into the personal and the political, because for Karunanidhi, these were actually inseparable. And that seems to be where a lot of his difficulty in later years came from, the personal aspect, both his family and keeping the party together with the seniors and the newcomers. Let's talk about the family first. In through the years, in the beginning, he seems like a part of a group of revolutionaries. And as you go through his life, people surrounding him more and more are his family members. And he's accused of nepotism, but also it seems to be coming from a lack of trust in others or keeping the party together, thinking of its future. What was your sense? I mean, it's one thing for what he said, but what was your sense of how he was actually managing it? Was it just a love for family? And you were also in the middle of a lot of drama in those years with Maran. So how was he? Why was this balance actually lopsided?
See, he was dependent on Mr. Muthusoli Maran for a range of advice. And hence, he genuinely felt that Maran's family should be given due space. But when that didn't really work the way he wanted, and when that entire Dinakaran episode happened, therefore, actually, when we are talking about this, we are talking about a very, very limited period of 2006 to 2018, where that actually decline happens. And unfortunately, that happens to be the fag end of his life, and hence everybody remembers. And that idea of giving importance for Maharans come from the fact that Maharans stood by him throughout this entire period. And Maharan becomes an MP, Lok Sabha MP in 1967. Therefore, negotiating Delhi was through Maharan's eyes. And that played a big role in his decision making. Like everybody else, your proximity to the family brings in certain amount of blinkers. I don't think he is also free from that. And for that blinkers, I think he paid a bigger price than anybody else.
You know, speaking of those, one of the reasons you told me when we spoke last about the book, for you to postpone the book's release was that you wanted to wait for the 2G spectrum scam verdict to come out. Why was that?
Yeah. See, I was very, very convinced that 2G case and Mr. Vinod Rai's fancy numbers are hurting India's democracy. And I was also convinced that Tamil Nadu will be able to come out of it quickly, but India and the dominant class, which are backing India against corruption, are going to pay a much bigger price. If I had written it without the judgment, people would have said that one fantastic idea of Vinod Rai is being replaced by another fantastic idea of Paneerselvam. So I wanted to wait to look for validation of my arguments. And the judgment clearly validated my position. And later, when we are able to see what is happening in the other parts of the country, I'm quite convinced that Tamil Nadu paid much lesser price for India against corruption and Vinod Rai's fanciful numbers. When you're going to look at corruption as an individual act and not as part of a larger political economy, when you're not going to talk about electoral bonds, what is this idea of corruption? Therefore, why corruption against Karunanidhi's and Lalu Prasad, the others, are corruption? And why the corruption against others are systematic? Therefore, these are the deeper questions which I was having in my mind. And I always felt that the Indian politicians are divided into two categories. One are Teflon-coated, another ones are non-Teflon-coated. Karunanidhi, Lalu Prasad, the other and all are non-Teflon-coated. You throw anything, it sticks on them. And there are others who are Teflon-coated, nothing sticks on them. Therefore, this was another category which I evolved personally because I was in journalism. We were looking at it. You're also comparing one event with another event. Being in media helped you to come up with certain personal categories, and these categories informed the way the book shaped, the final shape the book took later.
So how did he fall? How did you understand his, because you also began with the Sri Lanka connection. How did you understand his, how he felt about Sri Lanka and the Elam issue? It is something that I also care a lot about. So in those years, often he was both seen as someone who was by the rest of outside Tamil Nadu as someone who was secessionist and who was supporting separatist forces. But of course, among the Sri Lankan Tamils, they felt that Tamil Nadu was always betraying them and not standing up for the cause. What was your sense of where he fell in this issue?
See, this one is very, very clear. Right from the day TESO was formed, that is way back in 1986, he said that nobody can be the sole representative of any society, but you have a legitimate representational right. He said that DMK is not going to be the sole representative of Tamils of Tamil Nadu. Similarly, LTTE cannot be the sole representative of the Sri Lankan Tamils, but DMK has all the right to be the legitimate representative of Tamils. Similarly, they can also be the legitimacy of representing should not be confused with sole representational poleship, the pole position which Tigers wanted to take. And that was a key distinction which he made. And that distinction was lost out by the deep state as well as by the Tiger supporters. Deep state either wanted to endorse Tigers fully or to oppose Tigers fully. And Tigers wanted everybody to endorse them fully. But this idea of democratic negotiation of the space, that is the one which was absent there. See, that's the reason what we are witnessing in Tamil Nadu is on all the crucial issues, there will be always an all-party meeting which will come up with resolution, whether it is on Kaveri issue or NEET or Jallikattu. You immediately convene an all-party meeting to have a political consensus. This element was missing in the Tiger-led sole representative narrative. And he felt that that sole representative narrative is not helpful. And I think history proved him right.
You know, all through the book, coming to how you actually wrote the book, how you went through, you must have read so much of the autobiography, spoken to so many people. Even in interviews with Karunanidhi, or just simple, even 5-minute interviews, he ends it with, you know, one-liners or this deep philosophical observations or a line from literature. When you speak to somebody, even when he writes some of the things that you've quoted from his autobiography, for example, the story of him carrying Murasoli on his head and while crossing the river, and you know, to covering it with his veshti, and you know, going across. And when his friend asks him, "What are you doing, half naked, walking around?" and he says something to the effect of, "Let me go to the page 42." I found it quite fascinating. When we are working to erase the shame of our Tamil race, there is no place to worry about one's own shame. And I was like, dialogue. Then another time when he writes about what his wife, Padma, on her deathbed said, her last word was also about his political duties. You know, throughout it, at some point I started feeling, did you feel any sense of skepticism about his own version of events? And also, because he is a person, I don't ask it, I mean, anyone who is presenting their version in their autobiography, it is their version. But this is a person adept and talented at image making, at telling stories. So in that, so how did you navigate these stories that he's himself telling and others are telling of him?
Okay. I followed a simple method. For everything what I have quoted in the book, I had at least 2 more as a journalist, act of verification is very, very important for a journalist. Therefore, I brought in my journalistic tool to this. For each one of these things, we went and we cross-verified. For instance, that carrying Murasoli on his head, were covered with his veshti, it was confirmed by his friend Tennan. And Tennan was the person who actually asked that question. And Tennan says that it used to be a standing joke among them for years.
Do you remember Tennan, the Tamil line of that?
It's actually difficult because it is a much more loaded one, because it was also Kaveri on spate. It says that not every time Kaveri is on spate, you know. It was also talking about the Kaveri, and all those things were linked to it. The way it was in Thiruvarur. Now, coming back to this idea of putting out something, even about the criticism, I decided not to reproduce any criticism without subjecting it to a closer scrutiny. For instance, CPI had a series of criticism, but half of these criticism happened primarily because the way some of the Tamil concepts were translated into English. The Tamil idea of Inam is not race. Inam is actually ethnicity. The moment Inam gets translated into race, then the left critic of the DMK becomes pungent. But if you realize that Inam is not race, and they're talking about an ethnic grouping, it's a different one. As I said, these were all the nuances where I wanted to get in. I was actually checking the English version with the Tamil version. And in Tamil version, if you're actually looking at the expansion of these ideas, ideas were clearly expanded. The word called Inam has been clearly expanded as an ethnicity or ethnic grouping. It was not conflated as race. Therefore, the Dravidian enum is not Dravidian race, it's Dravidian ethnicity. And that's where the shared values and shared linguistic positions come in.
Mm.
Now, if one word getting mistranslated leads to a completely different set of arguments against the movement.
Yeah.
But the critic came from the idea that they are racist when they are not even using that term to denote a race.
Mm. You know, another aspect of you as a journalist, when you were with Sun TV, that was the year, 2001 was the year Karunanidhi was dragged at 1:30 a.m. and arrested by Jayalalitha. And I also remember watching it in Bangalore, waking up in the morning, and my father already had turned on the TV and we were watching it. And it was shocking. It was just, and then we started to realize at some point that maybe it was a 25 second or even less than that video that was on loop. And then they carried, Sun TV carried at the bottom. I shouldn't say they, maybe I should say you. you tell me. At the bottom, the ticker was people across Tamil Nadu and what they were feeling. They were sending messages, I don't know how, and that was being carried through the day. And more emotional messages were coming through. Of course, it was a deeply disturbing video of an old man being dragged, arrested in the, at night or Friday or something, so he had no option. You were the editor then. How were these decisions made and what part did you play?
First thing is the video team which reached Karunanidhi's house. It was a cameraman called Mari. He managed to get the footage. Initially, the police thought he was a police cameraman. Suddenly, they realized that he's an outsider. Then they chased him away. For the footage, what he managed to get was only that 25 seconds. As you said, it's correct. It's only 25 seconds. And he was chased away. Once Mari was chased away, we had no other additional footage. Because the rest of the footages were from that magistrate's place where he was remanded, then taken to the central prison. And those footages are the ones which were there. Where inside the house was this only 25 seconds. Footage reached Sun TV by 2 o'clock. Waited till 6 o'clock to put it out on air. Because felt that it's not fair to disturb the people at unearthly hours. So decided to vote, put it out at 6. What is that? Two instances were very, very clear. One is how to get people's opinion recorded. Because that was also a very, very strange election in which DMK lost. Vote share difference was very less, and yet they lost very badly. And it was essentially a bad electoral arrangement what DMK got into, which led to their defeat. Hence, they also had a solid vote share, which means we also wanted to know how people are reacting to such an event. Because here the FIR was filed at 9:40 in the night, and the arrest happened well past midnight. Therefore, we wanted people's reaction to come in, and that was the first time the phone-in worked very well.
Mm.
And most interesting thing is this focus on Mr. Karunanidhi's arrest started at 6 and lasted till noon. It's only for 6 hours.
Oh, felt much longer.
That's the most important thing. A lot of people are forgetting that. It was so effective that people think that it was there forever. It lasted for 6 hours, but 6 hours, well-structured arrangement. I always had an opinion that In fact, I was asked to write on this much later. If Kalanidhi Maran had not carried that arrest in that intensity, he would have accused of not being sympathetic to his grandfather. And he is purely a businessman making money. He has done it, and they say that, oh, you are a grandson who is doing it. The way he was, either way, he had to pay a price. But he chose to highlight this, and that actually helped. And that 6 hours was an extremely interesting exercise to know that how people also respond. We never knew that so many people will come out and make these phone-ins. In fact, most of the phone-ins, we couldn't really, the lines were jam-packed. People are not getting the line. Therefore, it was also, the fear was, if this is going to happen to a former chief minister, what will happen to others? And it was actually after the arrest of a journalist. Suresh, who was a Sun TV's correspondent, was arrested. And it, that entire program is also the manifestation of the general fear of reduction of the civil liberty space within the state. Therefore, the idea was to use iconic image like Karunanidhi to say that, what is the space available here? And that actually had a good pushback.
He led a dramatic life. We watched it, in full view of the world in that way, and had and would probably, and later when he came out of jail, he had made this emotional speech, I remember. And you also write about when he chokes up and everything, which anyone at that point would, I'm sure. In the absence of Karunanidhi now, how the party is taken its forming, it's been some year, 2018 he passed away, since then in the last 3 years, how have you been seeing the party and the ideas that he often, I guess, harped on or he pushed, how have they evolved or devolved?
See, from 77, it was two people who was running the party, Karunanidhi and Anbaragan, and now both of them have gone. But with the new leadership, we find all those elements coming with a sharp resonance, whether it is P.T. Thyagarajan as finance minister, or Shekhar Babu as HRNC minister, or Thangam Thinnaras as a minister for culture. What you see is that these ethos have not disappeared. In fact, they are coming back and they are articulating it in a for the next generation. Well, the way actually the GST has been debated in this state is an extension of that position. The way HRNC has been debated in the state is an extension of that position. Yeah. The way KLD has been articulated is an extension of that position. So I see that now they have a language which they are able to reach both domestically as well as outside. I think it took this time for them to arrive at this optimum mix of a language which you are able to reach domestic audience as well as the audience outside.
By language, you mean linguistic language?
I'm not mentioning it as a linguistic, as a narrative. See, if you want to mount a critique on centralization due to GST, you need a particular way to say, what are the problems of the GST? That language, or even the importance of your own excavations. What does it mean? What is the meaning of KDD? Or why HRNC under the government? Especially when you're talking about the separation between church and the state and HRNC, how are you going to look at it? Where do you locate HRNC in this separation of church and the state? These are all very, very important political questions. And that they are able to articulate in a manner which is not only addressing the local or the domestic constituency, but you are also able to address the constituency outside Tamil Nadu.
Now, I'm going to ask you my last couple of questions. Meanwhile, people who are listening, please ask your questions in the Q&A box. I see that there's some questions, but please do ask more. I'm on my last, so that you have enough time, half an hour, to discuss and ask Paneerselvam more questions about, he has a lot more stories that you can draw out. One of the things I wanted to ask was, you know, again, going back to your parallel with, you know, Marquez's biographer, you say that you had a conversation with Karunanidhi about using that as a model, and you shared the exchange between them, where Marquez told his biographer that everyone has three lives, a public life, a private life, and a secret life. And then Martin asked Marquez if he'll give him access to all three, the secret life, and Marquez said never. So when you told this to Karunanidhi, Karunanidhi says that actually people who are in public life like him have a fourth life, a life that they wish they had. So in the years that you've spent on this, and when you ask him whether you'll tell him about his wished for life, he said, you will find it from my autobiography, which I think ends in 2002, the six volumes. So in your research and your reading of autobiography, what do you think this wished for life is for Karunanidhi?
See, he always felt that all his colleagues were more privileged than him. When he becomes one of the young leaders of the DMK, all others had MA. Annadurai had an MA, Niranjan had an MA, Anbaragan had an MA, Aranganal had an MA, Madhyaragan had an MA, and he was a school dropout. When he was in films, he was working with people like T.R. Sundaram and the L.S.R. Dungan. They were all widely traveled with certain amount of global exposure. And his travel was from Tiruvarur to Salem. The way he realized that there is a gap. And what he said is, he had never said it explicitly, but there will be hints of these things. That is, he was working with people who had more privilege and who had better exposure. And hence, his job is to work doubly more. When he came into the idea of writing treatises much later for Thirukkural as well as for Sangam literature, he kept this in mind. He said that professors have done it, vice chancellors have done it, I'm getting into it. The way he knew that element, and that, I think that was the wish for element. Because at one level, he was talking about Jawaharlal Nehru's trajectory and about discovery of India. He says that after Eton and Cambridge, discovery of India seems to be natural. These are all hints. He had never actually... even if you're going through it very, very carefully, you're not going to find it explicitly stated. But since he gave that hint, after that hint, I tried to locate all these things. In fact, when I read it for the first time, these things completely escaped my attention. Therefore, it's also true that however you try to work diligently, quite a lot of things escape a human being's attention, and we have to accept the human frailties when dealing with these subjects.
Yeah. I'll ask my last thing before we ask take the audience questions. Please ask more questions, people. You know, in the aspect of actually having read so much of his, I'm sure you read many of his film scripts, if you read 67, I would drop dead right now. The 67 films he's written, and so many of the things that he's written. What is it about Tamil about Karunanidhi that we can understand? That you can understand. Those who can read Tamil can understand. That will elude always those who don't know him in Tamil.
The way he changed his language for each decade. He starts writing for cinema from 48. For each decade, you can see the change and shift in his prose. The prose was reinventing itself as contemporary prose for that decade. His prose was never ever belong to a particular period, because we know also to locate the period of a prose. And if you're actually analyzing the prose, you will see the way it moved. Further, when he writes for Palayavana Rojakal with Satyaraj, much later, the Palayavana Rojakal prose is completely different from the prose what he wrote for Sivaji Ganesan in Manogara. Therefore, the moment you hear Manogara, you know that it is early 50s. And the moment you hear Palayavana Rojakal, you know that it is mid 80s. And if you are the first two or three episodes of Ramanujam television serial, you know that it is 21st century. Therefore, the marking was very, very clear. There was a huge idea of what constitutes the contemporary prose. He had that wonderful grasp. Though he had never articulated how he managed to make these shifts. In fact, that was another thing which I actually wanted to talk to him, but I never completed it. But there's a distinct shift which happens there.
I'll read some of the questions. Aditya Sondi, who calls you APS, in the style of the of the OPS and EPS that we have in Tamil Nadu, but you're not in that party. So the question is, which Indian politician, according to you, is comparable in style and approach to Karunanidhi?
It's really difficult to look Karunanidhi's parallel with one politician. I always looked at somebody like EMS and Karunanidhi as important with reference to the writing and practicing. EMS was also a prolific writer, and Mr. Karunanidhi is a prolific writer. I liked Karunanidhi and Jyothi Bose because both of them are coalition builders. They can build broader coalitions. I also liked Karunanidhi and Mr. Lalu Prasad Yadav, because these two are the two non-Teflon coated politicians. And they are extremely significant. Mm. In fact, the UPA 2 happened because of the UPA 1's outstanding contribution of these two politicians. Then the Congress guys thought that they won. And they wanted to fix these two. And in the process, Congress got lost. I think RJD and DMK bounced back. And Congress is yet to come to terms with the loss of their excesses of UPA 2. That's a different story. I'm not going to get into it in this discussion. Mm-hmm. But Lalu is another interesting person. VP Singh, see, there are slivers of this. VP Singh, National Conference from Sheikh Abdullah onwards, there's a National Conference as certain elements of Karunanidhi. Akali Dal as certain elements of Karunanidhi. S.R. Bommai as interesting elements of Karunanidhi. Therefore, it's actually, these are all the politicians where you can see elements of Mr. Karunanidhi.
Right. There's another question. What was the reason the left parties, it's I think outside this discussion, but what was the reason the left parties could not use culture in politics with the same success that Dravidian parties did in spite of the outreach of the IPTA?
See, the left parties did have a huge impact. Let's not forget that somebody like Jayagandhan was part of the left. The thing is, DMK's numbers of people who were using art and culture were more than the number of people who were in the left. But I don't think left was not effective. It's not right. I think left was quite effective. And somebody like Jeeva managed to create a huge support system for the left and its cultural front.
It has been widely, Venkatesh Muthukrishnan asks, it has been widely agreed that performance by DMK governments were significantly better than AADMK governments. Yet DMK won only 4 assembly elections between 77 and now. How does one understand this, particularly when you have someone as astute as Karunanidhi at the helm?
Electoral results are the manifestation of electoral arithmetic. In fact, I think somewhere in the biography, I used these two things, electoral arithmetic versus electoral chemistry. The electoral arithmetic is the one which plays a big role. And that electoral arithmetic is the one which determines this also.
Right. And so are you saying, so Karunanidhi's electoral arithmetic wasn't working some of these times?
Yeah, not once. At least in 3 instances, it failed miserably.
And why do you think?
Including the 2001. Because in 2001, it was very, very clear what gave edge for the ADMK front. It was ADMK, CPM, CPI, Congress, Tamil Manila Congress. Look at the electoral arithmetic. See, at the end of the day, all you need is that the DMK has about 30% of vote share and ADMK has about 30% of the vote share. All you need is a sway of about 4% or 5%. If the electoral arithmetic is going to add up in such a manner, then it's going to get reflected in the outcomes.
Was this arithmetic his Achilles heel?
Arithmetic was also part of other factors. For instance, in 2001, the arithmetic has to go against him, primarily because he wanted to be part of this union government. Because the memory of 2 dismissals were looming large. And party cadres felt that the idea of being part of the center was vindicated when Karunanidhi himself was arrested within a few days of ADMK coming to power. But being part of the union government is the one which forced others not to join DMK. Therefore, if your survival for one period also truncates your longevity in the government.
Right.
I mean, it's sort of an ironic reality.
Tayil Sethumadhavan asks, sir, the subsequent auctioning of spectrum sales established that there was a substantial loss of revenue in the 2G allotment by the then minister. And the court decision only established the ineptness of the investigating agency. There is no Teflon. There is no Teflon coated cases of corruption. Corruption in any form is unacceptable. How do you justify such patent irregularities by whichever politician?
Okay, I am not getting into the question of this auctioning versus
allotment.
The earlier route which was adopted by A. Raja and minister still A. Raja, which was revenue share model. Revenue share model is essentially renting. We can't compare renting with outright sales. This itself is, I think, we are comparing apples and oranges. The way we can't use the outright sales of the spectrum with a revenue sharing model. And most important thing is what we are forgetting is that revenue sharing model generated enormous resources. In fact, it generated much more than outright sales. All you need to do is to go back to the TRAI website and look at the money the revenue sharing method had brought in. Revenue sharing model was bringing in enormous money year after year. It was a sort of a recurring revenue stream for the state. Whereas this outright sale has no recurring revenue stream for the state. I think there is a complete mismatch the moment we are not able to make this distinction between revenue sharing and outright sale of spectrum.
Saurav Karthikeyan asks, he asked about Karunanidhi's way of handling media and journalists, that it was quite different from today's politicians. You did mention a little bit of it, but maybe you can tell some of your personal insights.
See, most interesting thing is when you are meeting him for in a press conference, he will look at everybody and he will pause till you finish writing the full sentences what he has said. You will never run through it. I think that was a very, very important gesture from a leader. You ask him a question, he answers, and he dictates it in a particular speed so that you can write down. And remember, most of the people are taking down in longhand. And he permitted that space. And no uncomfortable question was difficult for him to handle. You can ask him the uncomfortable question. He might answer, or sometimes he might laugh. And he might... But there was space to pose that question. I think that is the most interesting element of it.
So you're saying he was not choosy about who he gave interviews to?
No, I think that nobody was stopped. In fact, the Jaya TV crew used to be given a major place. You'll ask them, which means give them the space. That's the most interesting one. Anyhow, that's a question which is going to come to him. Therefore, you wanted that question to come directly.
No, this is someone's asked. Sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, please. No, go ahead.
There's an anonymous person who's attending, whose question is this is a bit, we'll ask you to prescribe something actually, that what is the best model for a political party for the Dalit backward communities in the years to come, maybe next 10 or 20 years? What will such an approach result in? I think it's coming from when we were discussing the caste aspect, this question popped up.
See, I am a journalist. I can only report on what has happened. I'm not a political scientist. I can tell you about what all has been helpful in addressing this question. Therefore, I know that the First Amendment of 1950 helped in affirmative action. I know that Mandal Commission helped. I know that this formation of RJD, ESP, BSP, all of them had actually helped in addressing this question. Beyond this, to become a prescriptive, I think it's we should be asking a political scientist rather than a journalist.
Krishna Chidambi asks, what keeps the BJP out of Tamil Nadu, and what, if anything, has Karunanidhi to do with this?
I think BJP is kept out of Tamil Nadu because of Tamil modernity, which started around the time Vallalar came in. Because at some level, Vallalar's poetry, which talks about deep spiritual engagement, but which is extremely critical of organized religious bigotry, that is a bedrock. And that bedrock flows through 150, 160 years. From that bedrock comes somebody like Bharathiyar. From that bedrock comes somebody like Periyar. All of them are flowing from that bedrock. It's a very, very interesting one, because this is a language and the culture where spiritual quest is never confused with bigotry. The moment you are not able to confuse your spiritual quest and your bigotry, I don't think a party which wants to use only majoritarian aspirations can gain foothold.
And you think this is, as the Tamil populace also changes with influences of today, do you see that continuing?
Yes, because this support for a majoritarian position is not new. It has been in Tamil Nadu right from the beginning. if you're looking at even the Cherama Devi Gurukulam controversy, which happened in much earlier during the early days of the self-respect movement, we find that there is an element of majoritarian bigotry in the state. But as I said, this is actually reverse of what I said about the Dalit issues. Dalit issues are, yes, there is an element of discrimination. There is an amount of unfairness which has been meted out to them, but it has been extremely localized. Similarly, Hindutva is reality in Tamil Nadu, but Hindutva is extremely localized. It is not able to become a statewide phenomenon. But localized existence is there. It can be manifesting itself as Meenakshipuram episode, or it can come as Mandaikadi episode, or it can even come as the Coimbatore crisis much later. Therefore, nobody is saying that it's not existing. Yes, the Hindutva factor is there, but it's extremely localized and it's highly contained.
That's all. There's somebody asking, some, I don't think it's a question, there's one last comment on love for Tamil or mad love for Tamil. It was the only route to politically unite a diverse Tamil population. I think it's a comment by Saundar Rajan. So that's all the questions. And thank you, Mr. Paneer Selvan, for this wonderful discussion. And I hope that the people will read this book. It has some of, as he was saying, this is a perspective from within Tamil Nadu, from within his Karunanidhi's mind, also from understanding him in Tamil. This is the most well-researched book on biography of Karunanidhi, because Mr. Paneer Selvan has read so much of his own, of Karunanidhi's own writings in Tamil, and also known him for several years as a journalist working there. So do pick up a copy and read the book. And of course, then if you ask, you can send in readers, editors, emails, these questions as well. Thank you so much, everyone.
No, don't send any question to the reader's editor. Reader's editor job is specifically to deal with the Hindu.
Okay, find him somehow and ask him questions. All right. Yeah. Thank you so much. Thank you, BIC and Prakriti.
Thank you, Rohini. Thank you for Bangalore International Center. Thank you very much.